is Rock and Roll Grad School with your hosts, Heidi Hedquist and Luke Poling. They seem to have an invisible touch, yeah.
Hello, kiddies. We're going to have a good time together. And Heidi, this is when you get to actually just sit back and listen to.
I know. I get to do that periodically.
Because you were unfortunately unable to join me in talk. Oh, my God.
And I hate it when this happens.
I know. Ask me how the conversation with Zach went.
No, I don't want to. I don't even want to know.
Oh, my God. It was so good. It was.
I know. You already told me. What? You would just rub it in.
I know. But I just saw he was, I think, on Instagram posting photos of road cases getting the new Psychedelic Furs stencil on the side of them. So they are gearing up to get out. It's a fun interview. We don't really focus on any one record or one band because with him. And the one thing we didn't touch on was his drumming on River of Dreams, which is probably the thing that that's one of those things where you say, played on this song, did the drums. Everyone goes, oh, yeah, I know that one. Right. I know those beat. I know those drums.
Yes, this is a significant part of the song.
But we also get to talk B-52s, which is also nice.
That's great. Glad you had such a good time.
We did. Thanks for asking.
Hey, you're welcome.
And it's Kate Pearson's birthday today, yesterday, sometime this week or last week by this week. And then I know you're excited. Smokey Robinson's new album, Gasms, just dropped, which.
Ooh, that's such a dirty title.
I can't believe. And the cover is just Smokey's face.
Oh, I love Smokey's face.
I just love that. Because when Smokey sings, right? Is that, yes. Yeah. I mean, no one else could get away with that title.
No.
No one.
Nope.
Not Barry Manilow. Not none
I'm going
of those.
To see Barry Manilow.
You wait, what?
We're going, we got tickets to see Barry.
When?
It's in August.
Oh wow. That's amazing.
Yeah.
Is he gonna give without taking, do you think?
I don't know.
Oh, we'll have to get the full report after the show.
It's gonna be a good one. I don't know. I'm sure that
Who shot who?
Who shot who? Oh, the Copacabana?
Yeah.
Oh, clearly.
The hottest night spot in Havana. Come on.
I know. I'm sorry. I had yellow feathers in my hair. I was distracted.
I understand. I just can't dance and I can't sing. I saw you play last summer with Psychedelic Furs, and I noticed that your drum kit, this was in at the Parks Casino, I think Bensalem, PA. And it was way back against the back wall. And I didn't know if that was because of the stage and Richard Butler needs room to move, or is it because you play so damn loud?
No, it's because of the stage. My position changes depending on the stage.
Okay.
And luckily, no one has requested, you know, the plexi shield on me, which happened before. And just, you know, one more thing about that is, yes, I do have a history of playing so damn loud. You know, that's how I came up playing. The drummers I watched all played loud. Playing loud was, you know, desirable. You know, it was like it showed in the club environment that I was coming up in, mm-hmm. It translated. Now, in my later years, I'm playing quieter. So even with the Furs, I'm nowhere near as loud as I used to be.
Well, in doing research before talking with you, one of my favorite live Springsteen tracks is Light of Day off of the Plugged album. Mm. And I was like, oh my God, like, of course it's the same drummer. Of course it's the sound where I was like, I really like this guy's playing. I was like, clearly there's something about it that resonates deeply. But so in that playing loud, who were the folks you were looking up to and admiring their work?
Well, when I would go out to clubs, there was one guy in particular that I saw from a pretty early age. I was 15 when I saw Charlie Drayton play.
Mm-hmm.
And he played at a place called 7th Avenue South with the Floyd Brothers. And just the way he hit that drum made it speak in a way that immediately, you know, impacted me. And whenever I would see drummers and they didn't make the drums speak, I just thought they're not doing it right. Mm-hmm. And then of course you have drummers like Bonham, who had an incredible sound, and he hit, you know, pretty hard. And other drummers I saw were guys like Omar Hakim,
mm-hmm.
Who, although he had a lot of finesse, tended to hit on the harder side. He wasn't, you know, in that school of drummers that you'd call tappers, which was kind of like, you know, derogatory for me at that time. Now I've discovered that by tapping the drums, there's a whole nother world of sound available to you that, you know, I never developed, because I was never in a situation where I didn't play loud.
Mm-hmm.
And so I never developed the ability to play soft. And it was like not even a thing. It's funny because I didn't always play that way. Even after seeing Charlie, it didn't quite dawn on me that he was always doing rim shots. And I remember doing a gig in about 87. I did a tour with a bass player named Yossi Fine. And he said, you know, every time you hit the snare drum, it should be a rim shot. And it's not that I wasn't trying to, it's that I wasn't even aware of it. I was mm-hmm. like, if I was hitting rim shots, they were just, you know, by accident. And he told me you should always hit the rim shot. And so from the 80s on, I was always hitting rim shots. I was never playing the snare in any other way. And now I see that there's a whole other kind of way to speak with the drum very lightly. And it's fascinating to me, and I really give it credence, and I'm enjoying exploring it a lot.
I'm assuming you were self-taught, or did you have lessons?
I am definitely a self-taught drummer. Even though I have had lessons, I started simply by playing. And by the time I got to lessons, I wasn't really interested in doing all the practicing.
Some of those things were already ingrained.
Yeah, it wasn't satisfying.
Mm.
I played drums to satisfy myself, and I loved playing the way I played, which was, you know, with a lot of emotion. And making it speak and translating to the back of the room. You know, my thing was, you got to play the room. And if I saw a gig where it was in a club and, you know, you're dealing with the club, the house sound man. He's not necessarily your ally. And if the drums weren't coming off the stage, if they weren't speaking, I just thought, you know, that's not going to be me. I'm always going to speak to the whole room. And so that was, you know, the language that mm-hmm. I spoke for the first 20, 25 years of my career.
That's so interesting, because I mean, clearly the emotion is, again, such a strong part of it. And I feel like, because I don't mean playing loud as a substitute for any of the other things that any musician would bring to the table. And that it does have that feel to it. There's that, I don't know if you've seen it, the clip of George Plimpton playing with the New York Philharmonic, where Leonard Bernstein says to him, can you play the gong? And he hits the gong three times. And Bernstein says, well, that's great, but which one did you mean? And I feel like that emotion comes through, and it's that feeling comes through in your playing, even without maybe as big a dynamic as you've sort of discovered more recently.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it was also visual. Like, I think I'm very visually oriented, and when I see the drummer on stage, I want him to look the way it sounds. And so I always got very physical in my playing too, because I thought, you know, you're on that stage and you're trying to project your what you're feeling out to the people. And so the performance was the visual performance was just as much a part of it. So, you know, a lot of that meant if the snare drum is going thwack, thwack, you know, your arm has to be coming up here. You can't be going thwack, thwack down here.
Look right. Right. Yeah. Is that something, you know, the list of artists you've played with is incredibly impressive. You know, like we mentioned Springsteen, Billy Joel, and I know you toured with Bowie for a while. What was he like as a band leader and as far as sort of dictating the sound? Because he clearly explored a lot of different sounds and tried a bunch of different things. Was he a hands-on director or was it more of, I'll tell you when you're doing something I don't think fits?
You're talking about David Bowie?
Yes.
Yeah, he was not very hands-on. Mm-hmm. Definitely much more of, I'll tell you when something doesn't fit. And he's always been that way with all his musicians. He's always picked people that he thought would bring something, from the Spiders to the Damn rhythm section to, you know, whatever group it was. He really gave them a lot of room to just do their thing. And yeah, only occasionally would he give really direction. Otherwise, it was almost like if you messed up, he didn't care. It just added to everything for him.
Hmm. Was that something you appreciated or liked?
Oh yeah, much appreciated, because it made you really comfortable. Mm-hmm. Made you feel very comfortable and confident. And you know, I mean, the environment, it's your work environment. That's your office. So you want to feel comfortable in your office. And I've been pretty lucky that I've enjoyed working with all my bosses and never been in an office that was uncomfortable for me, pretty much.
That is pretty fortuitous to have that, you know, that not be stuck on something.
Not always the case.
Yeah. You
know, nightmare stories. And there are times when I wish somebody actually did demand more from me, because mm-hmm. I feel like I might have grown from that in a way that it took me longer to figure things out. But I certainly enjoyed the experience a lot more than you would if, you know, somebody's riding you hard and just, you know, I mean, obviously they can go overboard and it can just be a total nightmare, but I could have used a little more direction at times in retrospect.
Mm-hmm. Your first big tour was at the B-52s?
Yeah.
What was that like going from what you were used to playing to, I mean, they were on a rocket ship with that record and that tour especially.
Yeah, well, it didn't blast off until after the tour started. So it wasn't exactly like jumping on a moving train. It was more like, yeah, they were already 10 years in and, you know, were famous, but nobody knew what that record was going to do at the time. Mm-hmm. The tour was just intentionally initially going to be 5 weeks. So,
and then it wasn't,
which is very short for mm-hmm. And then it wasn't exactly. It just went on for over a year and it kept growing, but it grew, you know, it, I wouldn't say it was meteoric rise, but you know, it was pretty steady, mm-hmm. but it was gradual at the same time. We started out, it wasn't like, boom, okay, we're in arenas. We started out in clubs. And with pretty much a hardcore fan base. So that really felt good. You know, everybody was on the same page. It really felt like you were playing to your audience. And the more it started to grow, the more the audience became mainstream, which was great, you know, yeah. because this meant things got more and more high end. And, you know, everything got better. The travel got better. The hotels got better. The venues got better. And even though they were mainstream audiences, that record was so successful that they were there to party down no matter what. So, you know, that it still felt like in the initial days when it was really just people dressed up in beehives and with makeup and throwing candy on the stage and everything. But, you know, even with the mainstream audiences, when Fred said down, down for Rock Lobster, everybody went down on the floor, the whole arena, you know? Mm-hmm. So people were totally with it.
That's, yeah,
and they were great just as influences. I mean, I think they really had a huge influence on me personally.
Mm-hmm. How so?
Because of their artistic outlook and their sociopolitical outlook. I was just like ripe for you know, being molded, and they introduced me to so many things, you know, being socially aware of you know, causes, social causes, being aware of environmental causes, being aware of you know, gender rights, being aware of all kinds of things that were just in my periphery before, but never in focus. I lost what I was going to say. Also, as far as art, looking at and appreciating art, they kind of helped me define what I liked. Like, I hadn't realized till I was with them that I actually was a fan of Art Deco. I would have never said that before, but through them, I realized that. And growing up in the city, you know, I started to look at all the buildings that I grew up with, and suddenly I could appreciate them and, you know, realize like, oh, that one's from the 30s, that one's from the 20s, that one's from the 40s. Like, I started to understand that whole time period and how it developed. And I began, you know, one thing we would do is go antiquing on the road. And this is, you know, in the late 80s, early 90s, before it was like fashionable. And so we would find all kinds of great stuff. And then I would read books about the artistic movements of, you know, from Dadaism to the secessionists, to Art Nouveau, to Art Deco. And it just really opened up my mind. But at the same time, it helped me kind of solidify what I liked, because I was a graphic artist before I was a musician. Mm. I've always had a really deep appreciation for art. And they kind of rekindled that in me and helped me re-identify with it.
Yeah, and I see that. I mean, given their look, almost like it seems like, and I think if I'm reading you correctly, that they sort of not only practice what they preach, but that is who they are, maybe in a little bigger version, but what you see on stage is that band off stage.
Yeah, definitely. They're very honest. Their approach to music and art and performance is very honest. It is really who they are. You know, they're into kitsch, they're into being show busy, but not to where you go, okay, they're putting on an act. You can tell they're into all that stuff, but you can also tell, like you said, that's who they are.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just always fun. It was so much fun to be on the road with them.
And then
I only did that tour.
Mm-hmm.
And then I left after that tour.
I thought, did you play on Good Stuff?
And then, yeah, well, we played Good Stuff, but I didn't do that. I didn't do the Good Stuff tour.
I see. Okay.
I came back with them because Cindy didn't do that tour either.
Mm-hmm.
And I came back when Cindy came back, and we did a reunion tour in 94. And then I came back again for, it might not have been until 2000, actually. And then I did a lot of work with them from 2000 to 2006.
And that was the Funplex
called Funplex. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So I think one of the other big things, and I believe it was my third concert ever, was that Springsteen tour that you played on.
Mm.
What was that phone call like? I mean, that's someone coming down from Olympus or did it not feel like that at the time?
Yeah, it did. I mean, because the B-52 tour was so successful, it wasn't a total shock. Like, you know, on MTV every day, because the videos were just constantly playing, and we were touring, as I said, nonstop all over the world. I mean, we went to New Zealand, Australia, you know, Europe. And so it wasn't a complete shock. And even though obviously I grew up with Springsteen, I wasn't, you know, what you would call a Springsteen fan. So when it came again, I wasn't necessarily thinking, oh my God, the heavens just parted. It was more like, oh, okay, this is interesting. And then the person who called me, her name was Debbie Gold, rest in peace. She said something really interesting. She said, this is going to change your life. And I thought, well, my life was just changed. How much more could it change it? But she was right. It actually kicked things up to a new level. And touring with Bruce and seeing how he operated, that was like jumping on a moving train. I mean, again, this is a guy who's already been doing it for 20 years.
Right.
And had his whole MO down to a science, you know, with, you know, his security all on walkie-talkies and everything. And I mean, it was fascinating to see how thorough and how efficient a tour could run. You know, I mean, everything from like building your own stage and carrying that around with you to when you go out to a restaurant, you know, it's already been staked out by his security and they know where you're going to sit. Like everything is just, you know, it's kind of like how you think a diplomat or something would live.
Ambassador. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's like you are an ambassador, actually. You're an ambassador of goodwill, an ambassador of art. So not all bands are like that, you know, but that's the way Bruce's organization was. You know, and again, I didn't realize how big he was either. Like, I didn't know that he had written songs for the Pointer Sisters and songs, you know, for the movie with Joan Jett and Michael J. Fox, Light of Day, and just all these little pieces start to fall into place, and then you put the whole thing together and you're like, wow, this guy's really, really huge and super well respected. And you know, it's always fun to see stuff from the inside, because from the outside, it's, you know, we tend to look at it as just a circus, and it is, but on the inside there's actually it goes deeper than you think.
Mm-hmm. When you're on the road, do you play during off days, or are you kind of conditioned at that point where you don't need to rehearse and just keep limber?
For the kind of playing I did, for the most part, I never practiced. It was just playing. And I learned how to play that way, to play hard, to play simple, to play succinct, and to play with emotion. So that's not something that required practice. You just had to do it. And that's how I learned. I learned by doing, you know, playing in the clubs and stuff. But also on the road, it's important to stay healthy. And so rest days, off days, you really make them your off days, and you recharge. And especially when you're working for an artist, you know, like a Bowie or Springsteen, you're responsible to show up every day in top form. You know, doesn't mean you don't have fun, but it's not like when you're in a band and you can go party all night and miss the sound check next day and you're not going to get fired. When you're side, you have to be professional. You have to bring the goods every time, and you have to be dependable. So no, there wasn't much playing on off. You know, one time with Bruce, we showed up in a hotel. Can't remember where, it might have been Austria or something. And I get a call from the bass player, Tommy Sims, and he says, come downstairs. We're all jamming on in the ballroom because there's a wedding. And so we came down and we jammed for this person's wedding. So you know, but that's rare. That's like an impromptu thing where Bruce just decided to crash this person's wedding. And, you know, we kind of jumped in on the wedding band.
That's got to be anxiety producing, or maybe I'm just projecting on how I would feel. Like you said, when you're a session musician, that you need to be reliable. When that person turns around, they need to know that you will be there and you will be ready to go whenever they kind of give the house high sign or count it off.
Well, you know, when you're in your 20s, you think you're invincible. Mm. And as long as the person doesn't create any anxiety, then you don't feel it. And Bruce was just the nicest guy to work for. You know, he was the kind of guy where if you were rehearsing a song, and I'm a perfectionist and the whole band's are perfectionists, if you start to think about, all right, I want to play this this way, and ooh, I'm going to add, as soon as he hears that you're thinking, he'll be like, okay, we're not even going to rehearse that song anymore. Because he wants to keep it fresh. He wants it to be somewhat spontaneous. So yeah, maybe you could say that's anxiety producing in a way, but it wasn't. It was just like, let's just keep it. You know, he's not nitpicking, you know, and that makes you feel like you've got some elbow room, you know.
And then jumping ahead, how did you connect with the Butler brothers and kind of join Psychedelic Furs? Because that was maybe 3 years ago, 2 years ago, something like that.
Yeah, that was right at the beginning of the pandemic. I mean, just before the pandemic. But of course, we didn't announce it till 2021. Mm-hmm. Well, I had met them actually through the B-52s because we did a tour in 2000 and I was playing with the Bees and the Go-Go's. We were doing a Go-Go, it was the Go-Go's reunion tour with the B-52s, and we would switch nights headlining. One night the Go-Go's would open and one night the Bees would open for the Go-Go's. And then at the last minute, the Psychedelic Furs jumped on the tour. Literally like, you know, maybe a few days before the first show. And so they actually would open every night. And then we would rotate between the Go-Go's and the Bees. And I just got to know them through that. And so I think my name was always in the back of their mind as a possibility. And after their last album, Made of Rain, was a fantastic album. Paul, the drummer, decided he didn't want to do the tour. And so they were left hanging with no drummer. And they called me. Well, I got an email actually from Richard Fortus, who produced the record, saying, hey man, are you available? And I was like, yeah. And Fortus was actually the guitar player at the time when I met them in 2000.
Oh, okay. That's right. Yeah. So were you sort of, because you're officially a member of the band now, correct? Or is Wikipedia way off?
I haven't signed a contract as a band member.
But it's sort of, if they go out, you're going out with them as well as the other folks. Are they similarly, how hard is it for you in that particular situation? You're coming in, playing somebody else's tracks, kind of, do you listen to the records and the recordings and go, okay, well, here's how they did Pretty in Pink, or here's how I feel like this?
Ever since all the way back, I've always done that. I always believed that I was going to reproduce what's on the record. And so I always learned every fill. And I would do that or do a variation on it. Or if I thought there was room where I could expand a little, I would. But I pretty much just, you know, did what was there. I didn't believe in changing things up too much. And so that's kind of easy for me. This last record, Paul played some really challenging drum parts, I thought. So that's one of the hardest gigs I've ever had. was doing this Psychedelic Furs gig. But for the most part, I'm just, yeah, I just learn everything and then come in and I show up knowing it, basically.
Mm-hmm. And then now in playing with them, do you slowly kind of, I'm assuming just naturally from playing it, kind of something falls, one little fill or something that was on the record falls off one night and you don't put it back or something like that, where you're kind of slowly, inevitably integrating your style and your feel to the stuff?
Yeah. Yeah, that just happens because sometimes you don't even realize it. There's a song where, because sometimes you learn something really fast, you might miss one little detail and then you end up playing it your way for mm-hmm. months. And you go back and listen to the record and go, oh, wow, I didn't realize he opened the hi-hat right there. Or you know, there's an extra tom hit there that I've been missing. And so I like to go back and revisit the records just to see how far we've drifted away and if that's a good thing or if maybe we could, you know, I could bring something back in now that it's kind of, you know, there's a foundation there. And then sometimes I do make things very much my own. Like there's a song where I've pretty much changed the whole dialogue on the drums. I mean, it's the same beat essentially, mm-hmm. but I've chosen all my own fills and I play it almost the same every, like I build it. Hang on a sec. Now, of course, I'm blank on the song. You wouldn't understand.
That was going to be my follow-up. Let's see. It was on the last tour?
Yeah.
It should be. Because you guys pretty much played the same set list, I believe.
Yeah.
For most of the gigs.
Buried. It, well, we played, it changed. This last tour was different from the previous one. 2022 was different from 2021, but that song's in there.
Right. You'll Be Mine. Boy, they invented rock and roll.
An old song.
Oh, an old song. Let's see here. Do you want me to just go down the set list?
Mr. Jones.
Mr. Jones, okay.
Yeah, I've totally created my own roadmap for Mr. Jones. So that's something that I just hear it in my head and it just naturally sounds like it should have, you know, these fills would really fit nice in it. And so I do that. And so, and I do it with a very simple fill and I kind of repeat the fill and I build it thematically and that's become the new version. It's like my version. So sometimes you do change a thing. Mm-hmm. But it's not rare. Another thing too is, you know, and this is why I really believe in listening to recordings of rehearsals, because you might be doing something from the record, but depending on how it sounds live, it might not be translating the same way. It might not be working the same way. And so I'll hear a rehearsal tape and go, you know, I gotta change that. It's not working. Or man, I thought that really sounded good. And it's not. So for me, part of the process is listening. And if you can have a chance to record what you're doing and listen back to it, that is a big percentage of what dictates how I'll go, you know, forward from there. Mm-hmm.
It makes a ton of sense that the kind of like, yeah, going back and looking at it and going, does this work? Mm-hmm. And it seems like you must have sort of have the benefit of these other drummers who have played with some of the artists that you've worked with, that you almost go back and look through their body of work and kind of go, oh, well, I see how they do this. And sort of, again, that self-taught thing of going, well, here's how this person plays normally. And they have this, not trick, but they have this thing that they naturally do when they play. And so how can I adopt that? How can I, you know, morph that? It must be kind of a continuing education of listening how somebody else did it and kind of going, how do I emulate that in a way?
Right. And sometimes you know, I go into it thinking I'm gonna learn it perfectly, mm-hmm. but then as you're learning it, you go, I kind of rather would do it this way, or it's easier for me to do it this way.
Mm-hmm.
But definitely, I mean, with the B-52s, Charlie Drayton had played on that record.
Right.
And so that whole tour, I was teaching myself to play. It was like Charlie was my teacher.
Yeah.
You know, I was playing his parts, and every night, you know, getting into them, and every night making them happen. And, you know, each time you learn a little something about it. And then over time, you start to, however it makes sense to you, then you draw your conclusions, and then you can kind of make it your own in a way.
Yeah. Going back, is one thing that you wish you knew earlier as far as playing and music that you wish, do you wish you had a more traditional training, or is there something where you're just like, I'm glad I did it this way, or I wish I had done it that way?
I do wish I'd had more traditional training. There were guys that I remember who did drum corps, and mm-hmm. they always had really impressive rudiments and stuff like that, which was great. And I kind of envied it, but I didn't feel I needed to do it because I wasn't really using that in my gigs. Mm-hmm. None of the work I did really called for that. I feel like there's more call for it now. Did I say that right? More call for it now.
Yeah.
because drumming has changed, you know, like mm-hmm. in the first decade of your career, you sort of feel, and I think musicians feel like they've arrived and this is what it is. And you sort of think, this is great, you know, I figured it out. But then after a couple of decades pass, a new generation comes in, and they're not necessarily doing the same thing you did. And so some people are more chameleon-like and they want to change with the changing times. Some people just stay the same and do their own thing. I'm the kind of person who likes to keep moving forward, to keep progressing, keep developing. And so I now feel that I do regret not having more traditional training, mm-hmm. but it's something I can do now. So I'm not bored. I can sit and spend my time doing that, you know, and that's the beauty of art as you're living, is you can, well, I mean, anything, I guess, computer software development, you're going to keep moving forward. You're going to keep learning, keep expanding, keep exploring.
For more information on what Zachary is up to, check out his website, zackalford.com. You can find him on Facebook, where he's at facebook.com/Zachary Alford, a fan page. And he is on Instagram at Zachary Alford Official.
You can check us out on all the various socials. Be sure to visit our website at rockandrollgradschool.com. And don't forget to leave us a review.
Today's show is produced by myself and Heidi Hedquist. Our reluctant producers are John Sauvay and Sandy Stone. Our willing producers are Rachel Allen and Randy Jeanette. Our intern is Zach Jackson. This one's for Philippe. Thank you, good night, and may all your favorite bands stay together.